Lots of fun
stories.
I'd
like to hear what he has to say about Miami and Vegas, too.
Yeah, that's exactly right. We definitely want to get his opinion on that. But we got lots of good stuff for us, so stay tuned all the way through. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in on YouTube and Facebook and wherever else you're tuned into the radio station. We appreciate it. But we now have Mr. Daly connecting in via Zoom. We are very excited to have Conor. Conor Daly, welcome back to Speed City.
Thanks, guys. How are you?
Hey, buddy. Good to hear you.
Yeah, good to be here. Thanks for having me back.
Well, did you know this is a special evening for our relationship? And that sounds strange, but John will explain.
Conor, 10 years ago, June of 2012, you were our second driver guest ever.
And all right. Well, I appreciate that.
So it's 10 years, been 10 years since we've had you on the show. And just FYI, it was your buddy Alexander Rossi who was the first guest.
But you know what? That led us to a conversation about your career, because since we had you on, you were like in GP3 at the time. And I was saying, you know, what I like about Conor's career is that he's one of the few people that experienced both ladders to the top of motorsport, i.e. the road to Indy and effectively the road to FIA Formula One.
Yeah, no, I mean, you're not wrong. Took both roads. I think that was kind of, I guess it was necessary at the time because, you know, no one really goes from the road to Indy to F1. So we had to do both. But yeah, it was totally worth it. Definitely don't regret it at all. Was able to win on both ladders. So definitely proud of doing that.
Well, then you've just opened up one of the questions I had for you tonight, which was your comrades, your compatriots, Pato O'Ward and Colton Herta are kind of trying to keep a foot in both camps, as it were, and have been given a lease of life. I just wonder what your thought on effectively, you know, when you started and now, like you say, it's hard to do the road to Indy or be an Indy driver and be considered as a potential Formula One driver. What do you make of what McLaren are kind of doing to both help themselves and to help in effect Andretti Autosport?
Well, I think it's good on both accounts, right? To see Pato, you know, get that test last year, I think was great. I think many of us in IndyCar have known for a very long time that, you know, the sharp end of the grid at IndyCar is just as competitive yeah. as the sharp end of the grid in Formula One. But no one's ever going to, you know, it's just kind of not been a thing to where someone from over here gets to go over there. But we have seen, you know, some guys from Formula One come over to do the Indy 500, which has been, you know, really cool over the last decade. Certainly it has been different since I got into IndyCar with the era that I grew up watching. You know, there was no crossover really. There wasn't, that wasn't a thing in the mid early 2000s, whatever it is. But now it is. And you know, many other drivers in Formula One have talked about coming over to do the Indy 500. You know, we've got Scott McLaughlin over here yep. from V8 Supercars, Jimmy Johnson from NASCAR. So IndyCar certainly is the melting pot of everyone. I mean, everyone is coming to try to, you know, be a part of some of the most competitive motor racing in the world. But now I think there's a lot more respect as well for our series. You, yeah. know, you see guys like Colton and Pato, you know, get a shot maybe over there. I think that would be great. Will it actually happen? I mean, again, that's still a massive question that I think a lot of us have. Even some of the remarks that you know, some of the folks in the FIA and Formula One have said about Michael Andretti potentially starting a team are honestly like wildly offensive. I'm like, how can you guys immediately downplay a guy who is literally one of the most household names in motorsport history and probably has a ton of investors and a ton of money ready to do it properly? But
you've hit a nerve there, my friend. But I tell you why.
Yeah, Conor, I mean, I said it the first time I heard that, I was like, are you kidding me? This is Mario Andretti, and he's got probably American sponsors just lined up ready to bring money. So it's absurd.
Yeah, I mean, look, I grew up in an era of watching Formula One where you had teams like HRT and Marussia who were complete yeah. jokes of operations
yeah.
You know, out there. And so now it's just very confusing to me. Like, I love Formula One, obviously. It was a very, very strong part of my life for a very long time and still love a lot of the people that work over there and are friends with a lot of the drivers, right? Mm. But I just still, it's so blatant to me, the disrespect for American organizations or just what we have going on over here. Mm. And yet they're trying to fill the schedule with big American races. So at some point, I think that will cross over, and I'm excited to see that, you know, hopefully at some point we could maybe get an American driver over there to get a good chance or, you know, a proper, really well sorted out American team.
And Conor, as a European, and even though you come from a basically European startup, as it were, I can say this. I think it's true, and you, I'm sure, would agree, that there is a real arrogance in Europe about Americans and racing. What do they know? Blah, 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 blah. Oh, Alonso's going to the 500. He'll win it. You know, da, 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 da. And it's been both healthy and unhealthy, and it's certainly unhealthy in the way that the talent is dealt with, and it's certainly unhealthy in the way that prospects are considered. And I'm glad you got out and didn't go the Rossi route of being stuck with a Marussi or stuck with a Caterham and seeing your effectively brilliant career going down the panhole. And obviously Rossi did the right thing, won the 500, and the rest is history, as they say. And you could look at yours the same way. I mean, I'm delighted to be talking to you. We've had you on for so many years. And it was like, well, when do you think you'll be next in the car? And the truth is this year, you know when you're going to be doing. How does that feel for you personally to be knowing exactly where you're going to be come June 6th or whatever?
Well, I mean, my career has certainly been a roller coaster ride. There's no other way to describe it. But yeah, I mean, arguably I'm in probably the best position that I've been in my career. You know, we have a lot of work to do within our own, you know, our own selves at Ed Carpenter Racing. And I think they've done a great job, you know, working with us, me and Rinus VK, my teammate. And there are certain areas that through the last couple years, it's been some interesting schedules, right? So this will be the first year, although this will be my third year with the team, this is the first year that I'm going to work with my engineer at the 500 this year and all the ovals, right? And it's the first time that I'll drive for this team at all the ovals. So there's still a lot that we're kind of getting used to, you know, working with each other on. But yeah, we've got an incredible sponsor with Bit Nile. They've fully jumped in and embraced IndyCar. They love what they're seeing with, you know, how much our TV ratings have gone up in the first three races of the season. You know, I think there's a lot of hype around the sport. You know, the Indy 500 is fully back this year. Well, all of our events are fully back this year, but the Indy 500 obviously being the most important one that we need to have, you know, fully stocked with all the human beings that want to come and watch it. But yeah, definitely took me a while to get to this point, but you know, a lot of people have told me that, oh yeah, your 30s are really when your life starts. And so it kind of feels like that for me. I've learned a lot in my career to try to use it now in these next 2 years with this program, but I hope to obviously be with this team and in this sport for a very long time.
Mm. Yeah.
Hey, so BitNile, I don't want to, they're into the digital currencies and digital assets like NFTs and stuff like that, but they're a publicly traded company. So they're a huge company, right?
Yes. Yeah. And they're a part of a lot of other organizations as well. You know, Todd Ault is the main guy behind this, and you know, he is doing it the right way. You know, he's involved in multiple different business arenas. And you know, we saw Alzamend on Renus's car in Long Beach, which is again another company that Todd is involved with. We see it on Ed's car for the Indy 500, and there's a couple other companies with Earnity, which is a, you know, a crypto trading app, very much like a, you know, like a Coinbase or Robinhood type thing, but for the cryptocurrency space, and it's a very, very cool app. I mean, they've been giving away, you know, free crypto to a lot of people at all the races so far. It's an incredible program. You know, just to be getting people involved, and they want to do that. They want to give money to people to basically learn about the, you know, cryptocurrency space. So there's a lot going on, and it's a really cool program to be a part of. And you know, they brought 130 people to Long Beach.
Wow.
I mean, it's a ton of people, and that's what you want to see a sponsor do. You know what I mean? You want to see people embrace the power of the sport that we have right now.
Man, we've been watching crypto, all different kinds of crypto companies jump into motorsports.
Miami,
it's
yeah.
Really, yeah, I mean, it's all over the place, all over Formula One and IndyCar now. That's very cool to watch. Well, Conor, let's talk about this season, man. I'm looking at your races. You're getting higher up each finish. So, I mean, is that indicative of the comfort level you're talking about, that you're getting comfortable with everybody in this year's team?
Well, I mean, honestly, this year so far has been a story of several different issues that we've had. And you know, it's not an excuse type program. I know that if I made a mistake, you know, I'd be willing to admit it, but these things happen in racing. And, you know, in St. Pete, we set the fast lap of the race, and we were quick in the race, but, you know, happened to be on the less than ideal strategy and needed to make better fuel mileage and decided to make a call that, you know, that kind of took us out of a position to be in the top 10. And Texas, we had a technical issue as well, it ruined our pit speed limiter. So that caused some very obvious issues. So there's a few things there that have been through, you know, no fault of our own. And then Long Beach finally was more of a solid race for us at a track that we knew was our weakest. Last year was definitely our toughest track for both Renus and I. And again, we only qualified a few positions better, but in the race, you know, we were competitive and moving forward the whole time, which is important. And I mean, right now, the way you look at things in IndyCar, there's 26 full-time cars. And when you finish 12th, it's actually a great day. Like, it's actually solid. Yeah. And like, it used to be like, you're like, oh, well, it wasn't a top 10, but actually pretty stoked about it these days. And I think that's kind of the landscape is changing. It's not necessarily becoming NASCAR where a lot of teams are like, oh yeah, we're excited to finish in the top 20. But like, it's, you know, when you're up in the 10, 12 areas, I mean, that's, you know, you're fighting with Elio Castroneves, you're fighting with Felix Rosenquist, you're fighting with, you know, Scott Dixon started right next to me in 16, you know, 15th and 16th. So, you know, you got a lot of good people throughout this pack, and we needed a good race like that just to kind of get us going. And we know that our next three tracks, you know, we've been quicker at, so it should be good momentum.
Well, so I was thinking about what you said about finishing 12th and stuff, but I mean, Conor, I feel like your personal driving is, you're at the peak of your career right now. I feel like it looks like you're driving smarter, faster, better than you ever have.
Well, I think in a lot of ways, I've learned a lot. There's a few things that this new era of IndyCar have been a challenge for me, the AeroScreen era, but it has been for a lot of people.
Yeah.
We've seen it with, you know, Alex Rossi. We've seen it with guys like James Hinchcliffe. We've seen it with, I would say, Simon Pagenaud with Penske, although him switching teams, getting a new change of scenery, maybe a different setup, you know, idea or profile of sorts has helped him out. So something like that for me, we have figured some things out that have helped me with this AeroScreen car. But I think there are still a few things mechanically that we as a team can improve on. And I think we know that, but we also know that we're really quick races last year, the Indy 500 in particular. You know what I mean? We had the car to win that race. And, you know, realistically, that's what you want. You want to show up to Indy and have a shot at winning. And so we hope to do, you know, the same thing again this year and lead the right laps this time instead of the ones that we led last year.
All right. Well, let's get a quick break in and we'll be back more with Conor Daly. Listen to Speed City on Sunday night.
Grown up here his whole life. He got a huge round of applause at driver introduction. The flying mullet is flying out in front. Listen to the crowd. Oh, they went crazy.
Welcome back to the fastest hour in radio, Speed City.
All right, welcome back to the show. Conor Daly, was that just one of the greatest moments of your racing career? Leading the Indy 500, listening to that crowd scream.
Well, I mean, I couldn't hear anything. So at the time,
and just, you know, no pretense. And I think that comes across to everybody. And I think that's a big part of your popularity. And I mean, I think that is part of the package of a fantastic asset that is a race driver.
Well, I appreciate that. I mean, it was an interesting time in all of our lives for sure. And it was something that I was doing before the pandemic even kicked off. But obviously, you know, once everything else kind of shuts down, people start looking for avenues of entertainment, right? So, it was something that I enjoyed doing. I enjoyed, you know, building that community as well, because I still stream, you know, as much as I can. But the crazy thing is we were doing it so much. Now it's like, we have job, like our jobs are back. Like everything's full. Like I've been home. This is the first day I've been home as a full day in like 3 weeks. So like, it's, you know, it's hard to continue to do that. but it's such a great way to connect with people. And yeah, I mean, I'm always going to be me. I'm never not going to be myself. And I like to make people laugh. I like to make sure people are entertained. I like video games too. So it all kind of worked out.
Well, I think you're still getting my $5 a month off Twitter. So I'm keeping the flame alive. Jonathan,
Another question, just kind of for our audience, because I know, having been to the 500 and seen your dad dressed up in his flying gear and flying hat day of the race and did an interview with you then, and then obviously Doug Bowles. But a lot of people don't know, you know, the whole thing with you and how important that weekend is. And I want to add sort of Ed Carpenter, the sort of unicorn of pole there. That month of May must be so special to you, your family, your friends, and your business, your team.
For sure. I mean, as a driver myself, I mean, I am the only, you know, born and raised kid from Indiana, right? I mean, Ed Carpenter went to college in Indy, obviously grew up in Indy, very tied to the Indianapolis Speedway. But, you know, I believe, I, as far as I've been told, you know, he was not born in Indiana, right? Which is wild. But Ed is the hometown guy for sure. And everyone loves seeing Ed qualify on pole at the Speedway, run well at the Speedway, because he's very much an Indiana guy. And so is the team. But yeah, this is my hometown. It's my home race. And we love it. It's, you know, it's the biggest race in the world, and it still is. And I think this year, you know, truly has an opportunity to be, I mean, it was very cool to get to race against Fernando Alonso, obviously, right? Very, very cool to do that. Got to become friends with him as well. I think he's a great dude. But we've got guys now that are, you know, having their first Indy 500s that are quite a diverse amount of talent and a diverse amount of experience. I mean, Scott McLaughlin has already done an Indy 500, but he hasn't seen it in full, you know, massive, you know, spectacle. We've got Roman Grosjean coming over as a rookie. You've got Jimmy Johnson as a rookie at the Indy 500. You've got Callum Ilott as an Indy 500 rookie as well. A lot of guys with ties to Formula One and different racing series across the planet. And it just seems like a very special time to be involved in IndyCar. And obviously, you know, probably means a lot to win. It does every year, but, you know, it's just very cool to be a part of it right now. And, you know, we test there this week. We're on track Wednesday, Thursday. And so it'll be great to just get out there. Every lap there is very, very special for sure.
You said it, you had the fastest car last year. You led some laps. Is there something that you've got to crack in the month of May? You've got the Grand Prix and the 500 that you feel as a team, as a package with your engineer, you got to crack to be in that right position in the last 20 laps.
Well, I mean, honestly, it's just been pure luck. I mean, we qualified sixth at the Indy GP. I mean, we got taken out in the first corner by Pagano. And then, you know, we were leading the most laps of the Indy 500, and a tire falls off Graham Rahal's car and hits our nose. You know what I mean? So, like, it's stuff that you can't possibly explain.
Yeah.
But as my dad, you know, always told me, you know, all you just have to continue doing as a driver, and the only thing that you can worry about is putting yourself into a position to be successful.
Yeah, what you can control.
You know, If it does, you know, if you're doing your job, you know, if we have a great day in the pits, because the Indy 500 is so important in pit lane, right? We make six pit stops, potentially five or six, and you got to be perfect every time. And so that's, you know, that's a big area. But I feel like I have more confidence than I've ever had at the Speedway now. And I know what I want. And I know from last year to this year, there really is not a lot of, you know, technical changes in aerodynamics rules or what we can and can't run. So realistically, you know, we should have an idea of what is going to be good.
Conor, I want to go back to something you just said about it's a golden time in IndyCar, but I think it's maybe even bigger than that. I think it's such a huge time for all motorsports. It feels like this rising tide that's lifting all the series. And I was looking at a tweet that you tweeted a couple of weeks ago, or maybe a month ago or so, and you said you just finished watching Drive to Survive, and yet again, I can't see any doubts how good this is for Formula One. I don't care if they lied to me the whole show. Emotional stories are cool. The driver interviews are cool, and the race cars are the race cars. And I was reading an article about how many people have I've been watching this Drive to Survive, right? And not only that, there's a research study showed that they showed exactly how many people have watched it just in the first 2 weeks of this year. And I don't say it out loud. Oh! And I was just about to bet Connor, if he could come within 10% of the number, I'd give him $100.
Ah!
And so if you can guess how many people have watched Drive to Survive in the first 2 weeks of this season, if you can guess within 10%, I'm going to give you $100.
I mean, I don't even know. I feel like I should know because I've done a lot of research on this, but it has to be more than 20 million people.
57 million hours have watched. Sorry, I've totally messed up the entire bet.
Hours. Okay, but it was hours.
57 million.
You owe Conor Daly officially $100.
I think you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
Woohoo! So 57 million hours of that show, he's smiling, of this show have been watched. And I'm like, that is a stunning, mind-blowing number of how much.
And it actually changes them. If you were a sponsor, you know, we've been talking about that. And Connor, you can speak to this. That think about what that does to a Mercedes in terms of the overall year. I mean, yes, they've got, you know, it's all over the car, but this is such a different audience.
It's just supreme power. Yeah, I mean, you're talking about something that was put into place by this Liberty Media Group, right? It was something that was made to happen, right?
Yep.
Like, how do we get our sport to where we can pay the drivers more, we get to pay the teams more, and we get to have cooler races where everyone makes more money? Well, guess what? We're going to force it into everyone's faces. Mm. And what better platform to do that than what everyone has at their house? Netflix. You know what I mean? It's so smart. It's the smartest thing I've ever seen Formula One do in my lifetime, right?
Yeah, I agree.
And Formula One has always been powerful in my lifetime, right? Like, I grew up and you still see, you know, every event is packed. The Tifosi, you've got, you know, incredible fan bases all across the world. But not one person in America had any idea what was going on, right?
Pretty much.
Every single weekend, just yesterday, I was having dinner at a restaurant and a bunch of mid-20s individuals, especially a bunch of ladies too, are like, yep, we love Charles Leclerc. He's our favorite guy in Formula One now. And I'm like, well, that's awesome. I never thought I'd be having a conversation about the Ferrari Formula One team, you know, at a restaurant. And, like, it's incredible the amount of young people who find it to be so fascinating. I just had a buddy of mine, a DJ, who's like pretty popular DJ in the space here in North America. He was like, hey, bro, can you connect me with Lando Norris? Like, I'm a huge fan of watching the show. And I'm like, yeah, sure, whatever, like, here you go. And it's just, it's amazing what they have painted this picture. And I love it. I think there's still so many people who have these wild opinions about, oh, it's ridiculous, it makes certain people look bad. Like, we don't need, I even had people say, we don't need America to like Formula One this much. I was like, what are you guys talking about?
What does,
like,
that even mean?
Yeah, I was like, I literally look at some of these comments. I was like, do you guys not know how to add two and two? Like, this is money plus viewership equals success of something that you like. Like, it's like, I like it, you like it, we might like it for different reasons, but, like, if it's more successful, we're all going to be happy.
And actually, Netflix has achieved what Hollywood couldn't really do. They came close with Ron Howard a few times, and those films have all been good. But no one's really, really captured Formula One like this has.
And honestly, it's all about getting the hype factor, too. Once you have a bunch of people telling other people, hey, this show was cool, that's what it all – that's it. That's you. Then you're like, well, I got to watch it. Because I can't count how many times someone has told me, oh, that show was really cool, you got to watch it. And guess what I'm going to do? I'm like, well, he said it was cool, I'm going to go watch it. And I think, yes, it's good for Formula One, but I truly do believe it has done a lot for motorsport. Now, no one in Formula One or NASCAR or IndyCar, no one, I haven't really heard it, many people say, like, oh, let's all work together and all be successful, you know what I mean? Because it's competing sport bodies, right? But what that series has done is, I think, just basically shown more of an appreciation for motorsport, right?
Yeah.
Like, they're like, well, we watch Drive to Survive. It's like, well, you do similar to that? And we're like, well, yeah. And they're like, well, that's cool. Like, that's awesome. Right. Like, we probably, like, watch that too. You know what I mean? So I hope IndyCar can get a similar program. I don't think it'll happen, but I think we're working on it. And I think at some point, Maybe if we can produce something that brings people to that deeper level, right? Bring them into our lives a little bit more, bring them to the track, get them into the details. Because when you're at the track in an IndyCar race, I don't see anyone not having a good time. Like, it's a great immersive environment. And, you know, I could talk about that Drive to Survive series all day. Honestly, I'll talk your ears off about it. But I think it's great for motorsport. I think obviously all across the board racing right now is successful. And we love to see that because I like to have a job.
There you go. Yeah, we were talking earlier about the Haas team and how Gunter Steiner has become such a star. And it almost doesn't matter what the Haas team do on track. Some noise they're going to fire him because they haven't got any points. And I was like, no, they're not.
No, they're not. They're not firing Gunter Steiner. Let's face it. He may have been one of the early superstars kicked that season off when he stood there and said,
"Fuck the gene."
They can't say on the radio.
Yeah, there's always got to be a clown in a TV show. So, you know, he might be the guy. And I still think it's, you know, sad what they've always said about American drivers. So I don't really support them. But I do like Pietro Fittipaldi. He's a good pal of mine. So he's there, you know.
Well, Conor, I know you said that you have been on the road like crazy.
Yes,
you promised us two segments. And I would love to sit here and talk to you for the rest of the evening. But I know you probably need some rest. We really appreciate you coming on, and I hope you do well this season, and good luck in the 500 and everything.
Thank you, guys. No problem at all.
Hey, last question. Any chance you're going to be at Miami or next year at Vegas?
You know what? That is a great question. A lot of people have been asking me. Just last night, I had dinner with Callum Ilott, and he's going down. I think he has to be a reserve driver for Alpha or something there, and he was like, oh, you should come down. I think Rossi's going down. But I just don't know. I mean, it's Miami is not really my vibe. I don't really fit in very well there.
There's the Indiana boy coming out of you.
Yeah, but Vegas I would go to purely to be at an after party with Max and Daniel Ricciardo after Vegas. So, like, I won't go to the race.
And Lando.
Yeah.
Oh, that is great.
We'll make that happen. Well, we're going down there, and we'll probably, you know, try to meet up with Callum and a few others down there while we're down there.
There you go. I mean, who knows? Maybe I'll end up down there somehow.
You're always welcome on.
All right. Well, Conor Daly, thanks, buddy. We really appreciate it.
Hey, and good luck in May.
Thank you, guys.
All right, let's go to a quick break. You're listening to Speed City live from Austin. Back after these messages.
Hello to everyone. This is Gunter Steiner. This is Speed City.
Welcome back to the fastest hour in radio, Speed City.
You know what? I do not blame Conor Daly at all for having a little animosity towards the Haas F1 team. You know, they talked early days about American drivers, and there really hasn't been a lot of consideration. And I don't blame Haas for doing the Kevin Magnussen thing, because he just plugged right back into the system and had instant success, you know, for not going.
Yeah, I don't blame Haas for the attitude they took of not being, let's represent America. Haas is a successful NASCAR team. I don't think that was what Gene was thinking when he joined Formula One. He was looking at the global platform. And so that Andretti have said right from the get-go, we want an American in the car. That's Michael's dream as being not a failed, but not a successful Formula One driver. And it's Mario's dream, full circle, I think, to end his career going back to the thing that made him Mario, and therefore Michael, and therefore so on.
But, you know, I think it's, well, first of all, it's easier when you've got Colton Herta in your back pocket. It's easier, it's easier to say we're going to have an American driver, because they had one, a damn good one, and maybe the very best.
But that goes back to Conor just said, you know, he's enjoying racing currently in Indy because of the talent. And I think he's absolutely right. We've never had this depth of talent. Like he says, he's 16th on the grid, for example, up alongside literally the GOAT that is, you know. And then you start talking about Scott McLaughlin in Australia. People would literally bow down to him, his success. And likewise, you know, Dixon. But then you've got Castro Neves, and you've got these names that are just, you know, that are really word of mouthing it, not actually tweeting it.
Yeah. And obviously it's both. But I think you're right. I think if, you know, the old phrase, the old water cooler phrase,
yes,
is that if
that's exactly
you're telling someone face to face, I'm watching this right now. I think you're right. I probably watch more shows from a word of mouth directly saying, I'm watching this or I'm watching this. I think you're right. I think that is, at least for me. So,
by the way, I've got an answer for your question.
Oh, yes. We had a gentleman.
It's a semi-answer.
Thomas Steele, we're sorry we didn't see this during while Connor was here, but Thomas Steele asks on YouTube, he says, is Chevy the team to beat this year?
He's right, but not yet. And I say that because Penske are leading the way with Newgarten and McLaughlin. Last year's champion, a Honda player as Alex Palou, and of course, you know, Chip Ganassi, never count him out. But until the month of May is done and dusted, both Grand Prix and 500, I think the jury is out. And the reason I say that is always when you get to the 500, it's, well, you know, Honda have got the power, but, you know, they're going to blow up, or, you know, Chevrolet are coming back, but for a couple of years they were fallow and it was all Honda dominated. So right now, yes, you could look at the leaderboard and say Chevrolet are the, and you also look at the 500 with Pagenaud and so on and so forth. You know, there's an argument that says that Chevrolet are ahead, but it's a long season, and until we get through May, ask that question again, Mr. Steele, on June 1st, and I'll let you know.
Yeah. Well, I want to talk some more about this article that I was talking about with Conor Daly, because I was talking about 57 million hours watched, which is just mind-blowing, right? And now that translated to a 58% year-over-year viewership audience, right?
That's impressive.
I mean, that's crazy. But the whole, in this article, I just tweeted this out of our Speedcaster account a day or two ago, but it talks about the added value for F1 sponsors in Netflix Drive to Survive. And what they're talking about is we've all seen these kind of studies where they say, oh, because of the exposure, used to be product placement. Somebody was drinking a Coke on television.
Yes.
Well, now, because of Netflix, because of this Drive to Survive series, we've got the logo of the Mercedes, McLaren, Red Bull, everybody's all over these cars. And so they've quantified this value to the sponsors, right? And it is stunning how much total dollars are being brought to these teams, these sponsors.
Gosh.
Like, I mean, if you look at, I know you're looking at this article too,
yeah,
but like the top 10 sponsors, Mercedes got, because it's last year's, you know, mm-hmm, show that we're watching, but they got $6.5 million already. And this is only the first 2 weeks of this show, of the stats, right? And so, and like they're even pulling out specific sponsors like Petronas. That's the one, the $6.5 million. And like Uracali, the Russian sponsor, no more.
Yeah.
They got over $1 million of exposure, you know, if you were to go out and buy airtime or buy commercial time.
What about this for right at the top, obviously, Mercedes and Red Bull, total sponsorship value, $17.8 million?
It's crazy. It's crazy.
And they're not, Mercedes haven't pulled their wallet out.
Yeah, yeah. Well, so you think about it, and you go to a sponsor and go, okay, I'm going to charge you $1 million for the sponsorship, but I'm going to give you back $1 million in exposure.
Yeah.
I mean, it's to them, it's like, it's free.
So can we put a Speed City sticker on the HAAS car?
what you need to do is do something really funny during when we go to Miami while the Netflix is filming.
Is there water down there?
Yeah. There you go. That's true. You did fall in the water one time.
I have
got
done
a million
that.
Views on that.
Oh, mayhem.
Yeah.
Yes.
But yeah, this article, you should go look at it, because in total, $42 million in sponsorship exposure value just in the first 2 weeks of watching Drive to Survive.
God, I mean, come September or come November at the end of the season of Formula One?
Yeah.
My gosh.
What's that number going to be?
And look at the season of last year.
Yeah.
And look how it's opening up this year. Can you imagine how good Drive to Survive will be this year? You know, it's funny because we had MotoGP here in Austin a couple of weeks ago, and I was thinking they've got MotoGP Unlimited, which is on Prime. Amazon Prime, and it hasn't had the take up yet, and I still don't think they've quite connected the dots, and I think that's a lot to do with how present and who produces it and who they talk to and how they talk to them. I think one of the big failings that I thought of was a lot of, because obviously MotoGP is full of Spanish and Italian stars, but that's important. But they all speak English. We just went to the press conference. They all speak English.
Yeah.
But the series uses subtitles. And I, you know, yeah. it's hard to follow but you know, and if I'm, you know, if I'm really, really interested and a super, super charged fan, and I find it hard to follow because I have attention span stroke, you're concentrating on reading the subtitles to get the gist when frankly, a little bit of voiceover here and there, or at least the odd graphic to move time on or explain the situation you're about to see unfold, would be much more helpful. And obviously getting the protagonist to speak or use more English. If you want to make it happen here, it's probably popular as heck in Spain.
It's not simple to do what they did with Drive to Survive, because like you said, MotoGP did it. And you asked me this and I was analyzing and I was watching it with that critical eye. And what Formula One has is very mainstream young drivers. And MotoGP is kind of like the motorcycle world in general. It's a little bit of the bad boy, a little bit.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's good and bad, but it's not as mainstream and not as broad of an audience.
But I would argue that MotoGP is more superhero. And that, let's face it, this country is obsessed with Marvel comics and Marvel films. And I would argue that the Marc Marquez's and the Bastianinis of that sport are superhuman. I mean, Formula One drivers are superhuman. These motorcycle riders are almost more accessible. They're more real. They don't come from rich backgrounds. They're scrappers. They're harders. They're motocrossers. They're guys that are willing to put their life on the line. Yeah. And I know that's true of Formula One, but it seems to me anyway.
Well, it's even for sure statistically, it's very much more so in MotoGP.
And when you look at a motorcyclist in slow-mo and see where his bum is and how close it is to the ground or his arm and think, hey, if this goes wrong or this tire bursts, he's floating on that thing and he's going to come off and get hurt.
And I've only watched like two and a half episodes of the MotoGP. What's it called? MotoGP Unlimited.
Unlimited, yeah.
But I haven't seen, you know,
not a big fan of the title either.
Yeah. But the accident with Grosjean in Bahrain, fireball.
Yeah.
That episode was, you know, do you remember the Michael Jordan series that came out during the pandemic? I was glued to every episode of that. But that episode of Drive to Survive with the fireball that we were, you know, that they strung that 2 minutes out to 15, 20 minutes, is part of it. But that was the best sports television I've ever watched.
You know, it's interesting. I might get my buddy Tim, who was my cameraman back in the ESPN days when I was working for Formula One. And he was the cameraman on the 96 documentary on Damon Hill. Followed Damon all the way to winning that title. And I remember how tough it was for him to get access to, and he was just following one driver. And so what I'm getting at is I'd love to get the producers or some of the people involved in Drive to Survive and talk to them about the access. Because having been in that situation myself and how hard it is, you know, I mean, I did one interview, for example, with Rocky, with Sylvester Stallone, when they were doing or looking at doing that movie that eventually became an indie movie, but it started off as a Formula One movie and there was all sorts of people connected to it. But he came to Monza and I got an interview with him as the ESPN crew and so off. Mm-hmm. He was fine, he was promoting it. But just that alone, just getting to him at a race, etc., one crew, one man, one interview, no more than 5 minutes. That was a weekend's work. Mm. So what they're achieving in a weekend to get all that is amazing.
Yeah, and we got to take a break. But the last story on that is that when Netflix came to Austin last year and we were interviewing Gunther, I couldn't believe the crew. We sat down across—
Two crews.
Yeah, well, just the crew that came to— when we were interviewing Gunther, we sat down across a very small table in the hospitality. We sat down with Gunther and I held the Zoom across the table to interview him. And came in like these pterodactyls just swooping in, these microphones, huge microphones, like three of them came in between us. And I was like, holy, what is happening? And that, and then I looked around and there was like a dozen.
Did you feel inadequate with your Zoom?
I did feel my Zoom was my tiny little Zoom. But, all right, let's take our last break and we'll come back with lots more. You listen to Speed City live from Austin, Texas.
Hi, this is Magnus Walker. Greetings from downtown LA and thanks for tuning in to Speed City. Keep Austin weird and get out and drive. Pedal to the metal.
Welcome back to the fastest hour in radio, Speed City.
All right, welcome back. Let's talk Miami GP Formula One for a minute.
We're going to Miami.
Because, yes, we are. We will be doing the broadcast, the pre- and post-race show on national radio. Go to our website, speedcitybroadcast.com, to find out how to listen to that.
Do you know what I'm going to do for our fans, our viewers, our listeners? I'm gonna give up my soul. I'm going to go to Laguna Seca next week, and then I'm going to go back-to-back. I'm going to go to Sonoma, and I'm going to do SBRA and Trans Am, and then... just for them, I'm going to go to Miami, and then I'm going to go to London, and then I'm going to go to the historic Monte Carlo. And Monaco. So, you know, that's
why
my next 3 weeks.
Why?
Exactly. Well, because somebody's got to do it.
You're the second hardest working man in motorsport behind Conor Daly.
Yeah, and those are awful places, right? I mean, how
Jonathan
could I...
Jonathan Green.
But I just thought I'd give you my next month to just to, you know, just to... I'll try to give you as much as I can while I'm on that road.
Well, so three, but I'm just going to get excited about the Miami one. All because right. I'm not going to the rest of those. 3 weeks to Miami. You realize that?
Gosh, is it really?
Yeah, because we're at the 17th, so the 24th, the 1st, and then the 8th is the Miami Grand Prix.
Wow.
And so we will be there. We've got our house set up. We're going to be broadcasting from there. And
have we, though?
Well,
have we though, John? I mean,
we have the reservation. Do they know how to hold the reservation? That's the.
I think I might just go to bed on South Beach and then book. Can you bring champagne to that?
We have,
and that'd be it.
We have the reservation. It's just when I looked at the street view is when I went, do we want to change that reservation? It's right around the corner from the stadium. If you know anything about that area of Miami.
I'm excited by it because, okay, so, well, that was graphic. That was an illustration.
Yes.
But no, I'm excited because I was reading an article about sort of there's two things that are really important to Miami. It is a street circuit, but they've designed it in such a way, and it reminds me of Saudi Arabia, which is they've done the same thing, which is they've created 200-mile-an-hour straights leading into hairpins, which obviously create the overtaking that you would see at COTA. But then they've also created a street circuit, because it is a street circuit,
yep,
that requires a lot of grip, mechanical grip, and a lot of downforce. So it's going to be that classic conundrum of how do you set up, which is what COTA is so successful at. How do you set up for the twisty bits, and how do you set up for the straight? Do you want downforce? Or do you want to be fast and straight line? And either way is a compromise. And that's the beauty of motor racing.
Yeah. And then you plug in this year with the new aerodynamics, with the DRS equation that we're learning about literally every single week. You plug all that into Miami and you get a very interesting mix.
Yeah. And also the other story I was talking about was because they've started with a blank piece of paper, and because they're dealing with the owners of the Miami Dolphins, who know a little bit about hospitality and know a little bit about entertainment and know a little bit about marketing, because they have an NFL team in which will be driving around quite literally. They're in a huge opportunity to create great hospitality situations. They're doing a quasi Monaco feel to it, including building a beach and building a sort of yacht scenario, so almost a fake harbor, but it's still Miami. So, you know, the boats are there, the people that enjoy boats are there. It's got all these boxes ticked. There's even a pool and an area inside the track.
Yeah, it looks like a beat.
Austin has already been a success because it's had its longevity. It had a great circuit to begin with. But I've got a feeling that this should hit the ground running because of all the people and all the places that we've put in place here.
How fascinating is it going to be to go to Miami and, having lived through here in Austin, watched everything get built, and then watched going there on the Thursday night, watching them finishing the paint that we got them to see. We're going to see similar in Miami, I'm sure. But it feels very organized. I mean, you have have a very established sporting entertainment facility at the Miami Dolphins Stadium. So it's going to be really interesting to get to Miami and see what they've done. And I'm looking forward. I mean, I've seen the construction, but I'm looking forward to seeing the the garages, the whole infrastructure they've built.
Well, also, you know, the guys that are from Miami, the culture administrator and all the rest of it, have been to the Monaco event. They've looked around, a bit like our guys did when it was being built here in Austin. We sent people over to be guests of some Grand Prix. Silverstone was a good example. So, and again, you know, the city mayor of Miami, Francois Suarez, has been over there and had a look. So, you know, they're getting into it. They're taking it seriously. And it's already been a great destination for foreigners. And the key will be that Miami is 6 hours from Europe.
All right, well, we are out of time. Hey, everybody, don't forget, we do the pre- and post-race shows on national radio. Go to our website to find out how to listen to that. And we also have a new show every Wednesday on national radio. So go to our website and listen and find all those shows. Thanks for tuning in tonight, everybody. Thanks for tuning in on the radio, on YouTube and Facebook. And we'll talk to you next Sunday.
Happy trails.